Hello, this is Sheila Bender, and you're listening to In Conversation, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life. Today we have with us Esther Altschul-Helfgott, who is the author of Listening to Mozart, Poems of Alzheimer's, Dear Alzheimer's, A Caregiver's Diary and Poems, and The Homeless One, A Poem in Many Voices, among other works. Most recently, Esther's essays and poems appear in Caregiving in Alzheimer's and Other Dementias, and a chapter in Gary Glasner's Dementia Arts, Celebrating Creativity in Elder Care. She writes the blog Witnessing Alzheimer's, A Caregiver's View at the Seattle PI Online. Esther has a PhD in history from the University of Washington and is at work on a biography of Seattle psychoanalyst Dr. Edith Buxbaum. Welcome to our program, Esther.
Thank you, Sheila. Thank you for having me on.
I'm really looking forward to our talk, although it will venture into some very sad topics, and you've made beauty out of sadness in your life. And as I was reading the titles of your books and chapters, I realized I need to ask you to tell the listeners how it is you've come to do this work.
My husband had Alzheimer's, and he was diagnosed in about 2003. And I'm a diary writer from childhood. So I started keeping a diary specifically on what was happening with Abe. He was diagnosed in 2003, and he died in 2010. He probably had it before 2003. So that pretty much stopped all my other work, taking care of him. I was teaching at the time, but eventually I stopped and had to focus pretty much on caregiving. And the writing really kept me alive, I think kept us both.
I know that you felt at times that you were one person writing, that he was giving you the content and you were giving it the form and memory.
At some point, you know, I was always trying to get him to tell me what was going on with him. And in his moment, in his reality, if he did that, then I wrote down what he said. Mm-hmm. That was very special. And when he was in the later stages of Alzheimer's, when he couldn't, he could barely speak, I would give him a pen or pencil and have him tell me what he's thinking on the page, and he would draw a line or a circle or a curve. He hadn't spoken in, say, 2 weeks, and when I had done that, he made a form on the page, like a kind of curve, and he said a whole sentence. He said, "This is what I'm thinking." And that was amazing.
Mm-hmm. And does that appear in one of your poems then?
Yeah, it appears in one of the essays in Dear Alzheimer's.
Would you like to tell us about Dear Alzheimer's as a book, as a conception of a book, and then your next book, Listening to Mozart, and then perhaps read to us from them?
Okay, well, Dear Alzheimer's came about pretty spontaneously. I was writing and writing and writing, and then I started writing for the PI, the blogs, Witnessing Alzheimer's, A Caregiver's View, and that turned into Dear Alzheimer's, A Caregiver's Diary and Poems. So a lot of what's in the Dear Alzheimer's was on the blog, and then I filled in with the poems I was writing as well. So it ended up to be, I think, over 200 pages. Yeah, it ended up to be 265 pages, and I didn't plan this at all. It just sort of happened. The same thing with Listening to Mozart. When I couldn't write in the same form, when Abe was sick, after he died, I needed another means to write. So I started writing in haiku and tanka and keeping the diary that way. And that's how Listening to Mozart, Poems of Alzheimer's, came to be. And that wasn't until after he died.
Do you have any idea why you needed another form and why the form of haiku and tanka was so useful?
It's very interesting. Just writing across the page, free associating, as I've done all my life, and even writing in free verse, it just didn't work. I couldn't access my feelings. So I was reading about Japanese forms, and there's a woman in Australia named Amelia Fielden, and she says, keep a tanka diary or a haiku diary. And so I started doing that, And before that, Michael Dylan Welsh had invited me to read at his Redmond series at Soul Food Books, and I read what I was writing at the time. And afterwards, he came over to my table, and he took a pen, and he says, "Esther, do you know what you're writing?" I said, "No, I'm just writing." He took the pen, and he said, "You're writing Tonka." And he took out all the words that didn't belong and kept the words that did. And he says, "Here, you have a tonka. Go home and write 50 more."
Oh.
And it was just a wonderful encouragement. And that's when I learned about Amelia Fielden's work online, where she says, keep a diary. And then I started doing that, and I ended up with, gosh, about 100 tonka. And I didn't stick to form. I'm not very good at obeying rules. So I wrote some in haiku, some in tanka, then I did variations of both forms. And the haiku, of course, is 5, 7, 5 syllables in each line with 3 lines. And tanka is 5 lines, and 3, 7, 5, and then 7, 7. We have 5 lines. And so I did a variation of that form. And I love that book. I still can read it, and it helps me get through.
Listening to Mozart.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
but Dear Alzheimer's gets a little bit academic for me, but a lot of people really find it more useful, I think, than listening to Mozart, because they're going through the process. It's interesting to me that I didn't use those forms when I was a caregiver, when I was taking care of him. Last night, I was part of the production Memory Plays at Taproot Theater in Greenwood. Mm-hmm. And it's a wonderful little community theater. And they invited me to read poems before and after the Memory Care plays, which are 3 one-act plays. And it was a wonderful experience to be able to take my work out into a different venue. The house was packed. I think they seat 120 people. It's a small theater, but 2 nights, 120 people. It was very different from reading at a poetry reading or a bookstore, where people perhaps are looking at what form is she writing in, or is it a good poem, or accessible, or whatever. But this audience was specifically geared towards Alzheimer's and people who were taking care of their loved ones, many of whom also had Parkinson's. So these poems resonated with them a lot, and it makes me feel I want to do more of that work. I might even take an acting class, which I never thought of in my life.
I'm going to say that I know the venue is quite different, but I'm sure that it's the beauty of your poetry, not only that you share the experience with them, that is profound. I know how beautiful these poems are. Before we have you read, because we've been talking about haiku and tanka as forms, the intention besides the pattern that is there to adhere to or break in the case when you do, how would you describe either the sameness or the difference in terms of what that form, haiku or tanka or both, ask the writer to do, ask the poet to do, besides pay attention to syllables? The intent behind the forms is?
Feeling and soul.
Okay.
Just put what's the innermost feeling you have. Not that you don't do that in other forms, but the shortness of tanka and haiku is conducive to not worrying about a lot of language on the page. It gives you a lot of space around the page. You can take a lot of breath, which you need when you're grieving. And here's one I'm just opening, just leafing through the book, listening to Mozart right now. "I still feel your back rubs a little to the left. That's it." Mm-hmm. So that's all on one page, those few lines. I think it can help people just get their thoughts out.
Absolutely. So I'm curious, when Michael Dylan Welch took his pen and took out words and said, "Okay, now what's left is tanka," what kind of words did he take out?
And the, I think, articles, prepositions. I have that in my diary, actually, what he did with it. He took out punctuation, and instead of a comma, he did an M dash. And then I started working with the M dash, and I absolutely loved it. And I couldn't get rid of my M dashes. I had to start getting rid of them. I was putting too many in.
In the little one you just read to us, does it have an M dash?
I think it does. Well, here's one with an M dash. I can't find that other one. I write you onto the page. How else to keep you with me? Memory fades your wrinkles. So the M dash is after me.
All right, read it again, and then we'll know where it comes now.
Okay. I write you onto the page. How else to keep you with me? Memory fades your wrinkles.
Thank you. They're very moving because they get right to the image, the feeling, the question in this case.
The point. Yeah.
Yeah.
And here's one. I just scribbled, and with my M dashes, it came out looking like it belonged on the page. I buy a new pen, M dash. You slip from the nib. M dash, I write us home.
I can see how this form serves somebody who's in grief who needs to remember, because you're right there. When you're grieving, there isn't a lot of anything else. You're right there.
That's all there is. And the fact that there's so much space on the page, It makes me relax. When I go to Dear Alzheimer's, which was so important for me to write and sometimes in prose form as well as poem, there's a lot more on the page. I started, after putting the book together, I was thinking, well, should I take a lot of these words out? Because I was at a different place in my writing at that point when I was revising. And I decided to leave it as it was because that felt more honest, that I was connected to my inner self in that particular way through my writing at the time. And then I had a different sense of writing when after Abe died. And then it felt like a waste of time. I'm brushing my teeth now, I'm eating, I'm whatever. I don't feel like writing. And I did a lot more reading. Then as I was transitioning, I guess you'd say, from one writing space to another, the haiku and tanka came about, and I was very excited about it. And now, believe it or not, I can't use that form.
Oh, so
now I have to choose another form.
Are you in the process of choosing another form?
No, well, you know, I was working on another book of poems about my family of origin. And Sheila, it was just too much. I had done the Alzheimer's stuff and still working with groups and people who were involved with Alzheimer's. And then to get back into some of the pain that I felt from my family of origin days, I decided just to put it aside. And now I'm working on a project that I started long before Abe got sick, and that is a biography of a Vienna-born psychoanalyst named Edith Buxbaum, who practiced in Seattle from 1947 until 1980. She died in 82. So that gives me a distance from my own pain. I can deal with her pain in a different way.
Interesting.
Just as a historian. And my PhD is in history, not psychology or social work. And so this gives me time and space to utilize my field, which I studied as a younger person.
Just the evolving of the art that you're doing and the writing that you're doing is very interesting, because you just said that gives me a chance to use my field, the field I studied in. I think what you're telling us is that different forms seem to serve different purposes. Prose serves one purpose, poetry another, mixtures another, specific kinds of poetry like tanka yet another, and that maybe as writers we need to listen to ourselves and be open to which form is going to help us channel the information we have.
That's right. That's right.
You are listening to KPTZ 91.9 Port Townsend. In case you've just joined us, you're listening to In Conversation with Sheila Bender, discussions on writing and the writing life. Today, Sheila is talking with Seattle writing community builder, poet, and writer Esther Helfgott.
Would you mind reading to us from Dear Alzheimer's, since you have talked about it as very useful to the people who were in the theater last night, as well as others?
It goes from 2004 through 2010, so all start at November 2005 when he's still home with me. I tried to keep him home as long as I could, and that was about 3 or 4 years. And then he went to assisted living and then to Foss Nursing Home. So this is when he's still home. It's called Reading with Alzheimer's. Sprawled out in the recliner, wearing a tie-dyed shirt the kids gave him, a Middle Eastern yarmulke on his head, he holds a book of stories in his hands, turns the pages as he always did, carefully, respectfully, leaning, learning words the brain loses before he understands.
So it's a portrait.
Yeah, of him sitting there.
Yes, and I just don't think we should judge. Like you said, you like the Tonka better right now, but other people seem to benefit from your first book about Abe. I just think there's a place for it all, and that portrait's very touching too. The lesson I'm taking from you is to listen to what is going to help us write, which form, what to do.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the lesson I'm giving myself is don't judge what we've done if it's worked. Just because we've changed doesn't mean that writing that we created doesn't exist as something valuable.
Yes. And here's an example of that. In March 5th, 2009, one of the actors who was on the steering committee for the Memory Care plays asked me if I would read a poem on page 142 of Dear Alzheimer's. And I looked at that and I thought, I can't imagine why she wants me to read that. But she wanted me to start the event with that poem. And I'll read it to you. And then I have a longer one that we ended with last night. But here's one I didn't think was much of anything. March 5th, 2009. He's more now than he was then, before he lost who he was. A newborn, starting fresh, the whole world ahead of him. Is he really dying or just becoming something new?
Mm. Do you want to say anything about why you now know she might have wanted you to start with that?
Well, it's still not one of my favorite pieces. I mean, I actually don't even think of them as favorite pieces. It's what I had to write on that particular day, and that's how it came out. But people came up to me and told me how much it meant to them. And I think it's because the people who responded to it are in the throes of caregiving right now. And it speaks to people who are in that particular state. And I guess that's where I was. Because I have, after this, I say, I'm not at all sure what I mean by any of this. I don't believe in reincarnation or in those other lives some think we go to or come from. I think the body goes 6 feet under, if not cremated. And if there's a soul, the soul lives in the consciousness of those who are living. And do you want me to continue?
Sure.
If I were a true believer, maybe I'd think the soul goes back to God, but I'm not at all that true of a believer. What I know about God is nothing. If I said anything different, I'd be presumptuous. What I know of organized religion and tribal communities is that they carry with them an us and them mentality. I'm not free of this. That causes more problems than not. Yet when I look at the tininess of Abe, the sweetness and what seems like purity from the absence of toxins that too much life brings on, I see a new human being, unprotected, yet protected all the while. By what? I don't know. But something in his face, even when filled with discomfort, seems to say something else is happening to Abe, besides his dwindling away toward nothingness. Something seems to preserving him. I don't know what it is, but it seems holy. Do we all wear halos, but see them only towards the end?
Esther, that is gorgeous. Just beautiful. And I feel like only a poet could have written that prose-like piece. I think it's really hard sometimes to go back and look at our work and decide it's good enough, but it is extraordinary. Thank you for reading it.
Thank you.
So your event last night has you wanting to take acting lessons.
Yes, and it does. My kids can't believe it because I'm usually shy. But I thought maybe I'll do that because the actors were just wonderful. It could help me just in terms of self-confidence in front of people. And I don't know if I will, but I'm thinking about it.
Well, even thinking about it, it's good. Do you think it would change your writing? Would it be would it create a form for you, say playwriting, that you might want to
explore? I wrote the homeless one as a long poem, and people put that in play form.
Ah.
And that was way back in 2000, and I actually loved it because they asked the playwright to come up and talk about it, and they say, playwright. And so I did experience that, and it was wonderful. But I want to finish this biography before I take anything like that on again.
So tell us about the stage you are in with the biography, and have you done a lot of research? Is it a matter of putting it together at this point?
It's a matter of putting it together. I've done a number of articles on Edith Buxbaum, and I have a website, edithbuxbaum.com, and I've done blogs on her, and I did a letter to Edith, which was published in the Journal of Poetry Therapy, a number of other essays, and gave papers on her. But now I have to organize all the material into a book. And even though the research is done, it's very hard. It's harder than writing a poem for me.
Yes. So what are some of the obstacles you're facing?
Organizing. You know, what do I want? Like, I did a number of articles for HistoryLink on people who are in this biography. So I have all the information. I would love to make it like a poem, but I don't think it'll be that.
What would that mean, make it like a poem?
Well, I started thinking of it as an auto/biography, where I would write letters to her, and I would include my diary entries, maybe every other page or every other chapter. Now I'm thinking of putting that in an appendix. But my training as a historian always says, don't do that.
Why?
So I'm fighting against that because traditional biographies, you write, Edith Buxbaum was born in 1902, the daughter of parents, blah, 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 and give her chronological life. And she trained in Vienna, got a PhD in history, actually, at the University of Vienna in 1925, and then went on to train in child psychoanalysis with Anna Freud, the daughter of Sigmund. And then she worked for the underground in Austria before the Anschluss in 1939. And then so she left in 1937, went to New York, and she was there for 10 years and practiced lay psychoanalysis. And there's a difference between lay psychoanalysis and medical psychoanalysis. A medical psychoanalyst has an MD. Freud thought that anyone should be who was educated should be able to be a lay analyst, meaning not have a medical degree. Well, the American Medical Association stomped on that idea, and they tried to get rid of all the PhDs like Edith Buxbaum and Eric Erickson, for instance. Anna Freud, for instance, didn't have an MD. So anyway, these people were waived in, and they got in. But Edith in New York had to work in that milieu where she was perhaps looked down upon because she didn't have an MD.
You say your training as a historian keeps you from thinking you could structure your book as a poem. And as I listen to your poetry and this very interesting story about Edith, I'm thinking that for me as a reader, I would love to have your letters to her, and which I imagine might include your own background that you said was too painful to write about directly.
That's right. I've done one, and actually I think it's online.
Poets are always, I think, compelled to invent and to bring something to the world that isn't there yet. And I just think you exist in such an interesting place with all this knowledge of her life and all this knowledge of your life and this need to restore the memory of her work to people who don't know it or have forgotten it. And I just believe that something poetic would be a beautiful way to do that.
Well, that's very encouraging. Maybe I'll get right to the computer and try something. But, you know, it's how it comes out. And what I did when I was writing my dissertation, and I had the same problem. I wrote about the poet Irina Klepfisch. I used her poems as a way to tell an intellectual history of her life. But Buxbaum didn't write any poems.
But you have to write her poems if she could have written them. Or the way what you know about her has informed your ability to write about your own personal history. I think you've got something very beautiful and there, and I just hope you write it, because I think it would just write it the way you feel it. You know, and I think you have every reason in the world to believe you could structure this book of historical fact as a poem. And I think your letters would be extraordinary. Before we close today, I wonder if you might read a few more of the Tanka poems.
Okay. I have it divided into three parts, pulse, breath, and sinew. I use it as like an epigraph, my poem to the title, which is pulse. My love who has gone away came in a dream last night. He forgot to awaken me. And the second part is called breath. And I'm using a different person. I go from first person to second person to third person in this book. So I just wrote, I think I'm writing to the audience. Here's another one where I'm writing to the audience rather to Abe or to myself. Ann Carson writes, a brother's life never ends, nor does a husband's. Mine's still near me. Every day he's near me. Touch my arm, you feel his.
So beautiful. Do you have one more?
I have one more, which is Sinu. A woman is her body of work, her thinking inside her pen. At least that's true for me.
Thank you. Esther,
you're quite welcome.
Quite a poet. I'm so moved by what you wrote. I feel like I could live inside those poems for a long, long time.
Oh, I'm glad.
So, can you tell us about your website so we're sure that people can find out more about you and your books?
Yeah, it's estherhelfgott.com, and you can find everything that I've ever done on there, the links to the Seattle PI blog.
Oh, excellent.
It's on there, and the Edith Buxbaum blog. I also have a website about her. And my Facebook, everything else, everything in the world's on there.
Okay, and so I'm just going to spell Helfgott, H-E-L-F-G-O-T-T.
G as in God.
Right. Okay. So, Esther, you are doing a tremendous amount of writing, and I'm looking forward to more and to reading more. Thank you again so much.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
You have been listening to In Conversation, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life with Sheila Bender. For more of Sheila's interviews, please go to Sheila's website, writingitreal.com/audio. In Conversation is produced by Sheila Bender and edited by Charlie Fleischman. Announcer is Kurt Vanderslice.